Hachette Audio presents Meet Paris Oyster, a love affair with the perfect food. Written and read by Mireille Guiliano. Including an accompanying PDF of recipes. Ouverture. You might not be able to see the world through an oyster shell, but if you press your nose up to the window of a tiny oyster shack of a restaurant in Paris Saint-Germain-des-Prés area and view the dozen or so people feasting on platters of oysters and sipping wine, you can see Paris. The people, the passions, the culture, the Frenchness, the appetites, gastronomic and otherwise, the seductions, the fashion, the locals and the tourists, the banter, the drama, and feel the pulse of the city and its people. Welcome to Paris Oyster, the place of the shelled bivalve in French culture and life. Underlines the difference between France and the rest of the world, and between Paris and other world capitals. Where else on New Year's Eve do you see crates of oysters being proffered, one after another, on the sidewalks and in the food stores? What other city has 250 restaurants serving oysters and 25 devoted to not much else? Where else do you find people excited to rapture over slurping, slippery, gross-looking chunks of flesh down their gullets? Mmm, délicieux. Oysters grow all over the world, and people the world over eat them. They've never been so broadly and readily available and diverse. It can be argued that they have never been so popular. Yet, oysters in Paris are part of the French culture and identity. And the French are very patriotic in their types and accompaniments. It is a pleasure to introduce you to a lovely enclave of Paris and share advice on how to open, eat, and learn to love oysters, perhaps enticing those of you who haven't yet tried a raw oyster to take the leap and give this most nutritious of foods a try. I will also share some implicit and explicit cultural commentary, and some of my thoughts regarding what France's love affair with the oyster says about my native land. Taken together, braided, I hope these various elements come together into a work that indeed shows the world through an oyster shell in Paris. This partial slice of life play, this comédie humaine, is about pleasure and celebrating life. About joie de vivre and art de vivre. Perhaps enjoy it with a glass of champagne or Sancerre. Chapter 1. Huîtrerie Régis, Paris. The initial tip came nearly a decade ago from my Parisian friend Mélanie, who loves oysters almost as much as I do. "Huîtrerie Régis has just opened in your neighborhood," she emailed. "You must go. It's on the short street between the Marché Saint-Germain and the Boulevard Saint-Germain, and like no other place in the world. Sorry, but they don't take reservations." She knew I would love it. So I went and went. Between October and May, whenever I am in Paris, it is my cantine, though it's hard to call one of the tiniest restaurants possible a cafeteria. The oyster has a lot to do with why I go to this seemingly one-dish restaurant. But really, it's much more than that. A huîtrerie is basically an oyster bar, and there are plenty in town. But this is one of a kind. For one thing, as a regular pointed out to me early on, and only semi-jokingly, Régis picks his customers. And the customer is not the king here. Régis is. It's a restaurant with personality, an attitude, and the highest quality. I almost blew it with Régis on my first visit. When on a lovely fall day, my early morning plane arrival from New York became a late morning arrival, I was starving and a bit frustrated, so I thought a few oysters would reconcile me with the world. Plus, I was eager to test this new place. I arrived at almost 2 p.m., but I wasn't sure they'd serve me as the place was pretty packed. It doesn't take much for it to be filled, with only one gentleman seemingly ready to leave. A minute later, I had a table. I felt lucky. A great little table pour moi. The menu arrived immediately, and a fetchingly pert young waitress took my order 2 minutes later. And then I waited and waited and waited. In a one-dish restaurant, there is no amuse or appetizers or even a bread basket before the food. And the key in my head had still not switched from New York to Paris art de vivre. My stomach was growling, and I was wondering why it was taking so long to shuck a dozen oysters. Meanwhile, most customers were almost done or chatting over their espresso. I sat, feeling hungrier and hungrier. Edward, my husband of many decades, knows well that I can get grumpy fast when I'm very hungry. I was almost ready to ask if they had forgotten me. Plus, I had been in such a rush to go to the restaurant while it was still serving, 2 p.m. is a common cutoff time, that I came without my smartphone or anything to read. So I just sat there, and my expression surely turned into a glare. Régis, no doubt, read my face and did whatever it took to lengthen the pleasure or test me, as I later learned. He simply ignored me. Fortunately for me, I overheard a regular next to me mentioning how Régis was in a bad mood today after a morning telephone argument with a credit card machine sales rep, and so patience was required. Or was a man observing the show and trying to give me a heads up? That was definitely a hint I took as a favor and kept quiet and waited and waited and contemplated the restaurant. Apparently, as I learned after a few visits and conversations with regulars, for someone like Régis, who gets up very early 6 days a week, rushing is not in order. And those who are in a hurry better go elsewhere. Wow, how's that for customer service? That's how I learned his number one rule. Nobody gives me pressure. A few months later, a single man at the table next to me described what Régis calls difficult customers, or in his lexicon, bête noire, and his way of turning them down. Let them wait and wait. It's his definition of the ultimate luxury in business. Customers should be willing to wait. And so my platter of oysters was delivered 28 minutes after the order was taken. I was hot inside, but tried to be zen, or at least look zen. But then it seems that the love affair had started. Without my being aware of it, he discreetly looked at how I approached the bivalves, how I smelled them, tasted them. I had a hard time not devouring them, but then one doesn't do this with oysters. And followed with a piece of bread with a thick layer of salted butter. I fell right in some sort of gastronomic heaven, and it surely did wonders for the look on my face. Et voilà. Now, I somehow had gained a proved blessing, though nothing is ever acquired quickly in the world of Régis, and I certainly was not yet a member of the club. The short street is Rue Montfaucon in the 6th arrondissement. Huîtrerie Régis is at number 3. Now, imagine a storefront space that's about 18 feet wide and 15 feet deep. That's it, the entire restaurant. Enter the windowed exterior, and off to the right, say about 6 inches, is a small stand-up bar, more of a serving counter, behind which stands the shucker, the waitress, often Régis, the oysters, the wine, the coffee machine, the sink the size of a pasta pot, the silverware, the glassware, everything. The back wall is a wine cellar. A little room is squared off in the opposite back corner, the smallest toilette WC possible. On one side, a table and chairs abut the closet. In the dining room, there are 7 small tables accommodating 14 people. Snug is the operative word. The majority of the tables have inches at most of separation between them. But it works, partly because the French have a way of isolating and circling themselves in privacy in public. The way Americans are well known for talking to strangers right and left in restaurants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.